schedule seven presentation, let's say six presentation with an introductory overview of the research question by Mr. David Zimmerman. But unfortunately, Michael is not here with us, so we're going to have six presentations. But I think this part is going to be taken care of how RED related modeling result is going to be taken care of by Aileen. Huh? So Aileen will talk about this aspect, but we won't have the presentation about the mitigation strategy and biofuel by Michael. So let's start with Mr. David Zimmerman, who's going to give us an overview of the research question.
Whatever I didn't, and I can't do it, but I can edit. Okay, welcome. My name is David Zimmerman. I'm a professor at the UC Berkeley, and I'm really excited to be here. I've been working on climate change for quite a lot, many years actually. I've been working less on it in the last several years than in the 1990s. So I really will present a more conceptual overview of some of the big issues that relate to climate change and what does they mean for research. Now, I think one point that I'd like to emphasize is when you look at research and something like climate change, and that's what I did myself, is a lot of time it's important to raise problems. It's not only enough to apply techniques to problems that exist, but a lot of time you can raise problems yourself. My own self, I was working many years ago on starting with all the issue of soil carbon sequestration, will it work or won't it work, and then later on I started working on food versus fuel. So to some extent, a lot of time your responsibility is to identify some sort of a question and try to solve it, and a lot of time it's better to be the first that ask a question and may not solve it perfectly than to be the number 500 that solve the same question again and again. Okay, so let me speak a little bit about some of the...
I will
try to emphasize some of the basic issues of climate change and what to... And you move the climate move from the center to the poles. So you really start having a lot of shifting. So in the US, weather from Mexico will move to California. The Sahel will increase. Texas will be, part of it will become a desert. Some areas in Russia will increase in productivity. So what really happened is that climate change will really change the way that things are happening around the world. I think the first thing that we really, that I'd like to emphasize is that when we speak about the climate change, the key is not so much what will be the global effect, but what will be the local effect. Because if you are in an area that, if you're in an area that basically is subject to a loss or needs to adapt, that's what you have to do. And one of the big problems with economic research up to now is that people start to say, what is the global effect of climate change? And if the global effect is not that big, so don't worry about it. But I think that the big, that the first point is how climate change will affect different areas. Is it okay? The second thing is climate change is not only about movement of weather, but increasing stability. So all the issues, all the management of irrigation will basically will change over time. So the instability will enhance by rising water level, more extreme weather events, damage to ecosystem, increased vulnerability and political instability. And understanding these type of links are really important for analysis. How would agriculture will respond to these problems? The first thing is adaptation, and I'll speak a little bit about it later on. And adaptation is a lot of things. The simple thing in adaptation, it's not simple, is changing in crop system. But the other thing, it will be a major policy debate, and it's really important in the context of Africa, is developing capacity to redesign and reconstruction of water systems. So if you have an area that is very vulnerable to drought, and suddenly there is a change in water system and you need to build new canals and water projects, etc., it has to be done much faster than it was done in the past. So basically, this is, in my view, would be one of the most important areas of future research, how you evaluate infrastructure when things really start to change. Now, the other point is that the net effect will be smaller than the regional effect, and we really need to look at it. Now, I have this very simple model, but really it can explain a lot. Suppose you have two crops. One crop is, let's say, wheat, and the other a corn, and the other is wheat, or one is, and basically one is in the hot area and one is in the cold area. What happened in climate change is that corn moved north, wheat moved north. You have new areas that enter production, and you have another area that is becoming a desert. In principle, the net effect on yield is nothing. But what you really have, you have losers yields and gainers yield. So basically, there are three main effects. People will basically will suffer, they lose their jobs. People here will have new opportunities. And people here will have to switch from one crop to another. If you understand this figure, you understand 90% of climate change policy. So in an ideal world, what you have to do, you have to take people from the Sahel and move them to Russia. No. I start thinking about it. If you try to look and see, There is about five areas in the world where this thing happened. In the United States and Canada, you will have a movement from Mexico towards Canada, and it will happen. The area where the transition will be probably the smoothest, and it's happening now, no one speaks about it, is between Russia and China. Already there are more and more people, if you go to Russia, and there are more and more Chinese that move to Russia. So China, Russia will have better climate, China will have worse, people will move. But what about Africa? What about India and Pakistan? It's a time bomb. So the question is, what happened with the people here? And this is a huge problem with Africa. Now, it's a little bit more complex than that. You can move a little bit higher, you can grow crop in areas that you didn't grow because they were too high, you can increase intensity. But this type of figure, that is a key point. Now, why that is important? Because most of the economic analysis up to now try to say what will happen overall. And almost every study that people use came to the same conclusion, that overall the net effect will be small. You know, but I think that the key point is, if you are in Africa, I would worry about this. I would always worry about that switching here. And in a second, I say, what does it mean for research? So now, what type of... there are a lot of other effects that people have to take into account. The fertilization effect, which is the very good news. The daylight effect, that if you move to the north, you don't have as much direct sun, so you lose some yield. Now, something that I'll speak later on, which is very, very big, is the pest effect. That is huge. When I was in the 90s, we started developing a program, and people really don't realize, but one of the biggest problems with climate change will be that in some parts, pests will move a little bit, pests move faster than trees. Trees don't move, most trees. So when you really would have a big problem that you suddenly would lose a lot of trees, and you need to do something, because it's a problem but an opportunity. This is the first time that human will be able to manage forests and to change forests and to determine what trees you will grow. So all the definition of land use and land base will change. If people really believe that climate change is happening, a lot of our basic definition of land use would change. So if you say, what are the land allocation in Kenya? It may be different because suddenly, because of disease, area that was tree area suddenly became area that basically that you have to address new pests and you have to grow new trees. Now, this is not something that is usual, that is, but it's something that happened in the past. Then there is something that's called protein effect. People are very excited about the increase in carbon, but when you have too much carbon, you have less protein. But altogether, these effects are very important. Now, how do economists evaluate the impact of climate change? There are four methods. And I really think that it's really important to recognize them because each of them have a different perspective. The first approach is the Ricardian approach. People basically run regression of land use over. All of you are familiar with it, I guess. People run a regression, atomic price regression of land use price over temperature and say, okay, what will happen if temperature, what is the shadow price of every temperature? So if the temperature goes up by about 5 units, then yield goes up by a certain amount, and we change the value of the crops accordingly. So this method assumes that price relationship would be more or less the same. And so if you move, so if temperature will change, we will be able to assess the cost of the temperature going up or going down. So if you move from cold temperature to hot temperature, you gain. If you move from hot temperature to really hot, to super hot temperature, you lose. You understand, you have a quadratic function. So you gain when you move from cold to not so cold, and you lose when you move from hot to very hot. But the key problem with these models is that these models are assuming that the structure that we have now will occur in the future. Now, Bob Mendelsohn did some work for Africa along this line with a huge World Bank project that tried to use the hedonic price approach, but this approach had a lot of limitations. A second approach is the agroeconomic model. And there are several types of modeling that are using this type of approach. You try to say, what do we know about the relationship between temperature and yield? Now temperature will change, let's look and see what would be the best, the profit maximizing or expected utility maximizing system under the new conditions, and you believe that people will adapt accordingly, and this is the approach that people use with other partial or general equilibrium models. So the basic idea behind it, first you try to understand what will be the changes in the weather using some of the models that are developed by scientists. Then you try to look how weather translates to yield, and then you try to do a general equilibrium based on these models. Now, the biggest problem with these models is that they assume that you are able, that you will be able to solve an equilibrium in the future. But in reality, the big challenge is how you move from the present to this new equilibrium. And what type of institutional setup do you have to move from one system to another? Now, that is really important, and I'll speak about it later on. Then you have something that is called stochastic simulation. Namely, the basic idea about stochastic simulation is that you know that you have a lot of randomness. So you know that you have a lot of issues that it's not only that the temperature will shift, but you have a lot of variability and you have to take into account. So you develop crop models and production models that take into account the fact that you will have more floods, the fact that you will have more variability, and you develop a lot of small models for different locations that take into account all the variability. Now, why stochastic simulations are very important? Because stochastic simulation can be used to help you to design water projects, infrastructure, because one of the biggest problems that I see in climate change is how to design infrastructure. So think about it. If you have a situation that you have a dam and the dam doesn't capture water and you need to build a new dam, you have to know exactly how to do it and what would be the parameters. So stochastic simulations are very important. And the other thing is regional case studies. And that's something that we don't do very much, but are very important. You start with the city and you look at the stochastic simulation and you say, okay, if you look at the country, what type of system we need to know to solve the agricultural system, the political system, and the investment system. Because these are the three components. Farming system, investment system, the political system that supports it. Now, one of the things that is really happening is that we start understanding the impact of yield and weather. I think that this will be, if you ask me, one issue that will be very, very important. There have been some recent studies that involved Schlenker and other people that really show that when yield goes up, when the weather is rising beyond a certain threshold, yield starts falling down. Now, these results were presented in many forums and were published in Science. I heard probably the greatest economic historian that worked on agriculture, Professor Olmsted, and he really said that one of the things that are most interesting about agriculture, that we always had the capacity to select the varieties that have weather tolerance. So even with today's variety, if temperature goes up, yield may go down, there may be an element of adaptation. That to some extent, developing and understanding the impact of wind and weather and trying to use econometric technique to help to select varieties that would allow adaptation would be a huge challenge. Because if you really buy the yield weather analysis that some of the new models suggest, I think that we are in real trouble. But as an economic historian will tell you, humans were always able to move and to keep yields relatively quite fixed under conditions that were much more variable than these new studies are considering. So this is one issue that is very, very interesting. As I said before, the current impact have a lot of problems. Food prices generally reflect the temporal market situation. That's the reason that the carbon model are not problematic, are problematic. If you can solve a general equilibrium model, you solve an equilibrium relationship. But the key in all of the climate change is transition. How you deal with transition is really, really important. If you ask me what should be a key agenda is, how you develop a problem in transition. Suppose you have a flood. The key issue, so you have a flood in a region. You know that after the flood, things will be okay. But the question is how you move from the period after the flood till the period that it will be okay. You understand? Thinking about the transition, that to me is a big problem. As economists, we are not very good about it, but we really need to think about methodologies to assess it. So even when you use tools like CPE, it's important to look at them as tools that will assess you in transition rather than tools that will tell you what will happen later on. And understanding what is the optimal path and what needs to be done is very important. Now, this is something that is a very little figure that I call the transaction cost figure. Now, again, you remember this is one crop. So this is the hot crop, this is the cold crop. And the hot crop moves here, the cold crop moves here. In reality, you could have a situation that a certain area will switch from the hot crop to the cold crop. And that we also need to have new area in the north that would have to start being operated. So basically two things happen, switch of cropping and expansion of agricultural land. These are two very important things, switch of cropping and expansion of agricultural land. Now, today, if today you come, even in Africa, I don't speak about the U.S., and you say, I would like to expand agricultural land, what people will tell you? Because of climate change, I like to grow wheat in a certain area that it hasn't been grown before. You'll have environmental impact, so you'll have a lot of bureaucratic constraint and production cost constraint that will slow the adjustment. If you want to move from one crop to another, you will have a lot of costs. So assessing the transaction cost associated with adaptation is very, very important. People can speak about adaptation, but if you cannot do anything, adaptation is not possible. So to some extent, you can worry a lot about environmental considerations, but when the environment is changing, you cannot protect the old environment perfectly, so you have to take a lot of risks that are associated with adaptation. You understand? This is a very, very important point. If you think that a certain area would lose production and a certain area will increase production, you have to make some investment. And this investment may be risky. And being able to have methodologies to assess the risk-benefit analysis of adaptation is very, very important. Because honestly, if you ask me, what will be the impact of climate change in the long run? I said, not very much. But what will be the impact of climate change in the transition? I said, it will be terrible. There will be war, people will die, it will be really, really bad, unless we are able to adapt very fast. Clear? So basically the emphasis is how we do adaptation, basically right. Now, as I said before, the impact on biodiversity is very, very, will be really dramatic. And the fact that there will be a lot of losses of biodiversity is really sad, but it's part of the game. In some cases, we couldn't be able to support biodiversity. If trees will be destroyed, they will be destroyed. What happened is that things will die and things will be reborn. But this is something that you really have to recognize to be really tough to deal with. Now, how do we deal with adaptation? There are several ways we deal with adaptation. And near economists can think about it. Number one is migration. Migration has many forms. There is peaceful migration, and there is not peaceful migration. And the key about migration is that if the rate of migration is slow, that's one thing. But if the rate of migration is fast, you really have a lot of problems. So one of the things that's a positive. How many of you know this? If you look at the history, oh man, I'm sorry. I can. Did you know? Take me a minute. But this issue of migration is really, really problematic. And the reason that it's problematic, because if you speak about a lot of people that have to move from one place to another, you start really dealing with a lot of political issues. Now, this is not the first time in human history that we had big problems of climate change. There are people that suggest that a lot of the big changes in history were really related to changes in climate. The destruction of Rome was really related to the fact that there was global cooling that pushed people to the south. The movement of Islam from the Arab Peninsula to India was related to climate change. So how to have migration in a way that will be done reasonably is a big challenge. Okay, that's number one. The other form of adaptation is innovation. Now, innovation, a lot of innovation is done through a commercial system. But in many countries, people will need to think about understanding the innovation network and developing local innovation that can enable people to develop, to adapt to climate change. For example, there will be new diseases. So if you have new diseases that are weather-related, you need to develop pest control strategies. So developing systems of public research that will deal with it, that is very important. Then you have the issue of adoption of new technologies. Now, in my view, there are two ways to study adoption. One way to study adoption is to do experiments, which is very important, and to look and understand how or why people will adopt a specific technology. Another challenge that is very important is to have better understanding of what it takes to adopt technology much better. I give you a question. Do people adopt technology faster or slower in the last 20 years? What do you think? What? Because look at things. a lot of time people don't adopt technologies that scientists think that they should adopt, but they don't adopt them because they are not good for them. But on the other hand, if you look at technologies like cell phone, fax, the last several years, technologies were adopted very fast. And the reason is that we have an industry that basically specializes in technology adoption. People that are working in marketing know how to make technology adoption happen. So in my view, if you really want technology to be adopted, we really have to use some of the techniques that people use in marketing. And not all of the techniques in marketing are brainwashing. A lot of the techniques in marketing are based on understanding statistics. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the threshold model, but that's an economic model that basically is the disaggregated model that basically says that people will adopt things that are based on their own situation. So developing capacity to understand local varieties and to understand what makes people tick will be very important to help people to adopt new technology. Another form of adaptation that people don't think about it is trade. It may be that a certain area that grows trees cannot grow trees, but they can now grow something else and buy trees from some other place. I think not every time you have to migrate. In some areas you have to change occupation, and to some extent the optimal strategy will be to identify a new type of occupation and to develop trade to compensate. So combination of innovation and trade are very, very important. And thinking in this term is very important, because as economists, your leaders, you have to come to your government and say, look, these are the strategies that you have to take into account. Sometimes we may not be able to grow a certain crop, let's grow something else, but then develop some trade. So to some extent, all of it require interdisciplinary cooperation, research, planning, and also ability to dare and make changes. Now, the other thing is the issue of uncertainty. The biggest problem that I have with climate change is that climate change is very uncertain. No one, you see, climate change wouldn't knock on the door and say, I arrived. You don't know, it will take many years to know if it arrived or not, and when you don't know if climate change is arriving, you cannot take action. So the ability to develop an element of rapid response is very, very important. The ability to develop some indicators of how you define climate change and when you try to respond. And a lot of time you have to develop a lot of mechanism ahead of time. The good thing about the Kyoto Protocol is that people start thinking about what will happen in the future. But I think people have to start thinking about more practical things. Immigration policies, investment for infrastructure, and different type of regulation. So to me, now, the uncertainty is also at the problem with it, because when things are uncertain, people generally tend to be very slow in their action. This is the basic economic result, that people invest less or do less under uncertainty. So to some extent, we have to, as policymakers, to encourage government to be risk-neutral rather than risk-averse. Because if you take the risk-averse approach to climate change, you will do nothing till it will happen. If you take the risk-neutral approach to climate change, then you will plan. So thinking about different strategies under different assumptions about risk management is really, really important. Now, another thing is shape of locations is very, very important. A country that has a lot of people, like we have two countries. This is, let's say, closer to Ecuador, this is closer, farther away. So areas that has a lot of people that are hot, and a small amount of area that is cold is a loser, another area is a winner. So some countries will lose, other countries will win. We need to identify. Countries that will win maybe need to intensify its agriculture and its system. Countries that would lose, think about systems of basically relocation. To me, this is the toughest thing that you can have. The other thing is you need to have new environmental thinking. And I think that's what economists can do better than anyone else. The basic instinct when you are an environmentalist, and I'm an environmental economist, is to think in terms of preservation, conservation, protection, and endangered species, to think about making sure that nothing bad will happen to the present. But when we speak about climate change, we have to speak about adaptation. We have to think about how you change things. And developing analysis of impact of change are very important. Now, one very important issue is the issue of zoning law. For sure it's true in the United States, it will be very important in Africa. For example, do you want Lagos to grow up or to grow wide? When you speak about countries that population will go up from 200 million to 700 million, it will be very important if when you build cities, you build it up or you build it flat. That can really affect how you will be able to deal with climate change and what will be the cost that you deal with energy. So all the notion of zoning will be changing. People will be able, in order to deal with climate change more effectively, to reduce their energy emission by living in a way that is more dense. This is a huge challenge. And I think that in Africa say, oh God, it's irrelevant to us. To me that's the most relevant thing, because Africa will, population will grow, cities will grow. Thinking about zoning not only in terms of agriculture, but in terms of cities and how you build cities and how you develop systems that would allow to accommodate more people with a lower environmental footprint is very important. If you ask me about an important research agenda, is basically how you basically accommodate population growth. I can see that if existing trend will have, suddenly you will have huge acreage and increased suburbs and slum all over the place, like for example in Bombay, while here you have countries that are likely to grow, it may be worthwhile from the beginning to think about going a little bit up. People think, oh, it's not practical. It will be practical in about 10 or 15 years. Even now, think about Kenya. If people thought about it many years ago, I think things will be better in Kenya, Ethiopia, and other countries as population, as the number of people increase. Now, one other thing that is the only thing that I'm very specific and relate to my research is all the issue of biotechnology. In many African countries, people don't use biotechnology. I really think it's a huge problem. The reason that it's a huge problem because is that we don't have today any other tools to develop quick new crop system unless we use biotechnology. Biotechnology is not only genetic engineering, but all the molecular and cell biology. Now, if you look, for example, at the history of the United States. In the United States, it took 50 years to develop a crop system. 50 years. And if you look at Europe or Africa, it took much more. But when you have climate change, you like to develop a crop system in 10 years, in 15 years, not in 50 years. 50 years, you lose again. So you need tools that can do it very fast. So how you do it? You need the best biology that you can, and you need to invest in the best biology that you can. So if you cannot use GM and other varieties, you are in trouble. So you need new regulation that will make it sound. We need everything to make it safer, but you really need it. Because I really don't see, personally, any other alternative to change crop system. We speak about adaptation. You need to bring new varieties. You may need to bring the varieties from other parts of the world. How can you do it fast? Traditional breeding is very slow. So we, now another thing is that I have a study that try to look at, this is a summary of studies from all over the world on the impact of GM variety. GM variety in the two places in the world that has the biggest impact are India and Africa. Why? Temperatures are very high and you don't have a lot of pesticides. In the US or Canada, GM variety, where I'm in California, GM variety doesn't make a big difference. Why? We don't have a lot of pests. We have a desert. In South Africa, I don't think they make a big difference. It's dry, not a lot of pests. In Egypt, it will make a big difference. But in some areas that are humid, it can make a huge difference. That happens that the yield in India is very high. So basically what we did, we really tried to look at gain from GM varieties in different countries. And you see the developing countries in almost every crop that got much higher yield gain than developed countries. In cotton, that's one example that we have all over the world. Yield in developing countries like Brazil, Pakistan, now increased by 50-60%, now it's in Burkina Faso. To me, this issue has to be resolved. Soybean is another example. GM varieties, Roundup Ready soybean, allow you to increase the acreage of soybean and to basically to enable product, to basically to put, increase the, to feed livestock. We have these studies that basically show that the, because of increase the yield, the price effect, because of increase in yield, because of GM, at least contradicted the price rise because of biofuel. So to some extent, if we didn't have GM varieties, prices would be 20% or 30% higher for corn, soybean, etc. So to some extent, these varieties, even though they only were adopted in the US, Brazil, and Argentina, made already a big difference. If you introduce them to Europe and to Africa, you basically be able to have much more soybean and corn than you lose today for biofuel. So I think the issue of the GM and all these issues that relate to basically imaginary, all the issues that relate to GM regulation have to be resolved, and economists can be part of the process. Because without it, we will have a problem, and there is also another issue. If people realize that they have new technologies and people don't adopt them, then no one will invest in this new technology. So that's another thing. Another thing, so when we look at the impact of climate change, two main issues that one has to deal with, that any impact assessment has to take into account population growth and technological change. Now, the thing about this thing is that population growth as well as technological change can be part of policy. So to me, when you do any impact assessment of climate change, it's a lot of time worthwhile to introduce policy scenarios that you try to affect the outcome. You come to policymakers and say, okay, what happens if you have 3% increase in population versus 2% increase in population, and what would you gain for reduction? A reduction in population growth. I bet that the best investment that one can have in any country in the world to deal with climate change is investment in some sort of a population control policy. And you can use economic analysis to assess it. It's not true everywhere, but it's true someplace. The same thing is to try to look at the impact of climate change when you are active and when you look at technological change from this perspective. Now, so this is basically when it comes to the impact of climate change. Now let's look at issues of the principles for policies and then to speak about some of the policies that people use. Okay, so obviously the key in the policy is emphasized on R&D. Now, when you look at new technologies, you have to look at on adaptive management, namely develop basically learn and develop at the same time. Constant reassessment of what you're doing. You need to think about policies that from the beginning think about relocation. And the other thing is no regret policies. Policies that are climate change policies should be policies that provide benefit if climate change is not occurring as intensively as you expect them. That will be also the best way to sell these policies. So if, for example, you have a policy that can increase agricultural productivity even without climate change, but it will protect you against climate change, you'll be much easier to sell it than you say, we have a policy that will be only good for climate change. Now, the reason that biofuel has been so successful politically, it has a lot of problems, is that biofuel is not only a climate change policy, I'm not sure if it's a great climate change policy, but it addresses the issue of fuel security. That to some extent, when you look at policies, don't look at how we develop climate change policy. But I will develop a climate change policy that can meet other objectives. Now, I think there are two types of things that we have to mention. First, the issue of not only trying to assess the impact of climate change, but trying to understand what are the impact of high energy costs on Africa in general and on the economy in general. I am personally convinced that the financial crisis was affected by energy cost, by high energy costs more than anything else. High energy cost is a huge issue. I think we really need to understand what are the impact of high energy costs on consumers, on producers, on farmers, and anyone else. We speak too much about what happened to climate change in the future. We don't speak about what is the impact of high energy cost in the present. I don't see a lot of CPE models that try to predict what the impact of high energy cost in Africa. And what are the political implications of high energy cost? You know one thing? No, France once thought about having a carbon tax. They abolished it. French people supposedly care about climate change. No country in the world doing anything about energy prices. Why? We really don't have any assessment on what are the impact of high energy costs on consumers today and on society. If we understand it, then we can do something about it. We cannot speak about carbon taxes and energy taxes and all this other stuff without knowing how people feel about energy prices. If you're a poor person and you're in a village and you have to pay twice for the gasoline or to heat your home, or if you are a guy that low middle class that has a car and suddenly the cost of the gasoline doubles, forget about climate change. You don't really care about anything, you will vote against any policy. You may be a great environmentalist, but if you cannot drive your car, you will rather have a car and you'll let your kid worry about climate change when it happens. So I really think understanding how energy affects people is really, really important. And energy prices is a big problem. And I think and then when you remember I spoke about building tall cities, that would really be something that you can deal with. If the price of energy is going up, that would be one type of solution. I really think that we speak too much about what will happen 50 years from now and not what's happening now. And what's happening now is we have a combination of high food prices and high energy prices. And when people speak about food, they say, oh, let's worry about food and the real super poor. But the people that really vote are the middle class. In every country, most people are middle class, even that country. And these people now suffer from high food prices and high energy prices. And to me, that is a key element for research agenda. Now, mitigation can really be a solution, but it's a small solution. Now, mitigation as an element of soil carbon sequestration and tree carbon sequestration. I feel that I can be very confident about this topic, because I was in charge of a research tank when the U.S. Under Clinton, where the Clinton administration introduced big time the notion of soil carbon sequestration. It was opposed by a lot of European countries, and they had good reason to oppose it. And it was now becoming a big hit for people all over the world, in Africa, Brazil, etc. Now, obviously, it can help the poor to some extent, but we have to know that there are a lot of problems we have to deal with. First, assessing the impact of sequestration activity is very difficult. And if you have carbon market or carbon trading and you cannot measure it, it's a problem. So you need to develop methods for measurement. Secondly, suppose a farmer in Uganda gets a certain amount of money for using no tillage, because that's the most practical policy, to use no tillage. And after 10 years he decides to start tilling the land. Price of wheat goes up, the price of sorghum goes up, you want to increase yield and till the land. will someone come to him and say, God, you get money and you promise us not to till the land forever? People really don't trust agriculture, that people will do things that will last forever. So that's the reason that the only policies that may work are policies like RED. But even when it comes to a policy like RED, you get a little bit of money, not to the forest, but if suddenly you can make a lot of money by cutting the tree, who will have the power in the world to tell you, forget about it, you signed the contract? It rarely happened in history that you basically, that people were able to enforce contracts that relate to farmers. So I think that is one thing that is important. That this type, why does it matter? Because the people that give money for this program basically are very skeptical. So RED has now $10 billion, how much RED has? $10 billion. It looks a lot of money, but you have to realize that Africa has to share it with Latin America. Probably much of the money, if not most of the money, will go to Latin America, the Caribbean. A small amount of money will come to Africa. $2 billion looks like a lot, but you really speak, it's really small amount of money relative to the need. So to say, okay, let's change all of our production, like my friend Pedro Sanchez said, let's have in Africa carbon farmers, I don't think so. It can be an incremental start, it can be an important start, but you really have to develop a sustainability program that basically will generate high revenue per acre, and it will be a complementary thing rather than the big thing. So to me, the big challenge in agriculture is not to say, look, how do we reduce carbon, but how do we employ, how do we improve the situation of the people, including the use of mitigation programs. I think this is a very important thing, to really to try to estimate what is the impact. Suppose these policies work, how much will they help really the poor? Who will be the poor people that will really benefit from it? Now, I have a list of some of the basic activities that you can really need to do in order to really develop this type of program. You need to have good management, you need to have regional organization that distribute the money. So research to develop how you manage this program is very valuable. How to manage programs that pay for soil carbon or tree carbon sequestration. But on the other hand, that's not the only solution. That's one of the solutions. And even when you look at climate change, to me it's a small part of climate change. The big issues in climate change is how you develop system to adapt, how you develop system to move very fast, and how you basically deal with high energy prices. So the problem is, as I said before, it's very important to design this thing, but that is not all of it. It may be that one or two people will become a specialist, but that would be only a small part in a global program on climate change. So to some extent, my conclusion is that climate change increases the value of good management and flexibility. It will benefit from research and international collaboration. It requires a lot of sacrifice. But the basic policy issues that we are dealing with are really difficult. These are policies you really need to speak about peaceful relocation of many people, which was done. Look at Africa, look at every place in the world. Relocation is the most difficult thing that we have in the world. Now, part of the big issues in climate change, I'll speak about it on Wednesday, that people from other continents will try to come to Africa. How do you deal with that? The second thing, you speak about issues of developing new technologies and adapting new technologies. You speak about developing production system that will be much more flexible and much more fast. And then you speak about mitigation. So I really think the research agenda is really, really challenging. I think that some of the modeling that we have today are very powerful. I think we have quite good modeling to assess equilibrium. I think that the big challenge is develop modeling and policies to deal with transition. I think the good thing and bad thing about climate change is that it's a dynamic phenomenon under a lot of uncertainty. It makes for great research, that it may make for quite a difficult life. So we have to help make people life much better if we do good policy work.
All right. Thank you.